light for everyone present here, including us, who are so deeply immersed into the work that we do here at Sakaar. So sometimes it helps to actually stand outside and see and make sense of what we are trying to do. And that is to listen to a variety of perspectives, a variety of voices on this theme of what a systematic study of Sri Aurobindo's work means to us in a very personal sort of way. And when we came up with this topic, when we came up with this panel, we really encouraged the participants, the speakers who will be participating in this panel, to speak from the heart or speak from the mind or a combination of the two, however they, whatever comes to them really from within, and share with us what this experience of a systematic study of Sri Aurobindo's works has meant to them, whether it's as a part of their intellectual process, intellectual journey, as part of their own inner journey. So we were very happy when we wrote the first email to several students, and we were very happy when we finally selected the four people whom I would like to invite to come and join us here at these chairs. So we have with us today Chandra Pichal from Pondicherry, and Siddharthan from Coimbatore? Huh? From Kerala. Anshuman from Auroville. And Gitanjali from Chennai. So these four have very kindly agreed to share with us some of their reflections on what this experience has meant to them. And like I said, it's also meant for us, sort of the so-called insiders to Sakaar. So otherwise, you know, we are all part of Sakaar. But just as facilitators or as people who are trying to do something here, we would like to hear ourselves what this experience has meant to them. And on a personal note, I would also like to add that I have had the privilege and opportunity to work with all four of them. And we just have had different roles in what we call as our online classrooms. You know, I get to have the title facilitator and they are learners, but in true, the truth of the matter is that we really are co-learners and co-facilitators in this journey. So with that, I would now like to welcome my own co-learners and co-facilitators in this journey. And I think we would start with Siddharthan.
Hi. My name is Siddharthan. I come from Kerala. Used to teach philosophy to undergraduates in one of the colleges in Kerala. Retired since 2003. And now I am full-time into counseling. Even before retirement itself, I had gone into this psychology, because earlier my discipline was philosophy. Then having teaching students who were unwilling to listen to philosophy. Maybe my fault, but I got bored. And then I had to switch over to some other subject that fancied me. That's how I came to psychology and counseling and all that. Basically, my psychology training is in transactional analysis. And I have an organization, non-governmental organization called Emotional Literacy Mission Kerala. I'm the founding director. It's engaged in giving counseling to students all over Kerala, especially in the district of Alappuzha, from which I come. That's all about myself. And I'm here to tell you or share with you what the study of Sri Aurobindo's philosophy or works has meant to me personally. I'm not supposed to present things in a rather academic manner. And of course, in introducing me itself, it was said that I'm going to share with you my personal reflections or what impact it had on me as a person psychologically. Did it facilitate my inner journey, and intellectually in which manner it had impact. So to begin with, I will say that personally, it had given me a lot of relief. It cleared away a lot of confusion. Because when I came to psychology, I had a lot of confusion because there were very many systems or concepts which were at loggerheads with one another. Depth psychology of Freud, and then behaviorist psychology of Watson and Skinner and so on. And they were not in agreement. And then when I took up my study of transactional analysis in earnest, the confusion was confounded. So I did not know what was the cause of this confusion. But when I came to Sri Aurobindo studies, then only I got the idea, I got this light that the confusion stems from this one single fact that all the other psychological systems try to repair human beings without trying to understand what man is. They're all dealing with personalities, but not with the person behind the personality. So that was the one thing that gave me relief and that helped me in overcoming my confusion. And with the help of this insight, now I am in a better way to carry on with my mass counseling, and that's the one topic on which I'm doing my PhD in Sakar. But unhappily, that program is now hanging fire. I don't know what will happen to my PhD because of some bureaucratic muddling back there at Delhi with IGNU. Hopefully, it will be cleared. Anyway, so the study goes on. And now it's becoming rather very clear to me that counseling can be done in a very short span of time also. Earlier, I was taught counseling in a rather systematic manner, which added to the confusion, in fact. What are the counseling steps? Some of you at least must be knowing. But they never thought of the process involved. My study of Sri Aurobindo has given me this insight about the process involved in counseling. The first process is that one should turn inward, one should look inward. If I can facilitate a person to look inward, that will be the starting point of counseling. And that may be a single individual, or it could be a group, or even it could be a mass. And I'm not speaking from a theoretical perspective, but I am speaking also from my own experience. We keep doing mass counseling. Earlier also I used to do, on the basis of transactional analysis, I used to do mass counseling. But that did not create the impact that I desired. Because when we go to schools, you know, there are students who don't care for anything. They don't want to better themselves. They don't even want to listen to their own teachers. How about coming out from the rut of habits in which they are caught? There was no question of that. But even then, we used to give them counseling. Counseling, that is, I go into a classroom and then start saying something about psychological things and other things, so that they will be at peace with themselves because of their various experiences at back home and in the school and on the way to the school and back from the school and all. Their mind is agitated. They are not at peace. They are unable to concentrate their mind. So this one problem is not addressed in our educational system. You keep on revamping the educational system, but this factor is not taken into account. That the students who sit in the classroom are not in a fit position to really, pay attention to the class, the material that is being taught to them. So this problem has to be addressed. That's why we intervened. We tried to intervene with the help of the municipality of Alappi. That's a district in Kerala. This is the fourth year we are doing this mass counseling program for the students of that district, municipality. This time we are doing counseling for almost 10,000 students from 8th standard to 12th standard. Some 26 institutions are involved. So we kept on doing this without knowing, you know, what is actually needed. Because the paradigm was that of the Western cycle, you know. Give them some ideas about how to have some self-improvement. But then after coming across the works of Sri Aurobindo, I could understand that man basically, the identity of man basically is not understood. The identity. See, this counseling process can be found even in Ramayana, even in Bhagavata, there are beautiful episodes of counseling. The sage Vasishtha counsels Rama, the avatar. And in that counseling, the sage reminds Rama who he is. So he had forgotten his identity. So with this insight, when I read Aurobindo, and especially with the help of A.S. Dalal's wonderful works, that has given me a very good entry into the Aurobindonian thought, which is rather difficult to understand for a person like me. So I could understand that this is the basic counseling involved. So one should know oneself. One's experience will create a lot of turmoil, which is basically made up of three components. That is, body sensation will be there, emotional upheavals will be there, and thoughts also will be generated. With any sense input, any contact with, when I come in contact with the other, there will be these three things cropping up. And they solidify, petrify into self-image, the ahankara, the ego sense, which hides the true self. So psychotherapy is a process through which we'll have to remove this self-image that has to be broken, chipped off, piece by piece. So if this can be done, this process can be done on a mass scale, I think the divinization of society spoken of by Sri Aurobindo can be actualized. So the process of mass counseling is, I think, is something that we have to look forward to. I mean, the process of refining it, and I think the refinement may come to such a stage that just by speaking for 5 minutes may be able to transform people's attitudes. So we'll be able to, this is my hope, you know, we'll be able to induce the person to look inward, and having turned his attention inward, he can witness what's happening within, so that he can become a sakshi, a detached witness of what's happening within, and will not be influenced by the other. Otherwise, whenever I come in contact with the other creates what I call enhavior, which is the root of behavior. The word enhavior is a new word created by me. I don't know how far it is going to be legitimate, but I wanted to express the source of behavior is enhavior. That has three components. That is, body sensation is there, emotions are there, and also thoughts are there. And I came to identify myself with these three. That's the root cause of my misery. So this I could understand with the help of Aurobindo's integral psychology. Thank you for your patient listening.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I am Gitanjali. I am a Punjabi from the other side, Pakistan, Lahore, as a refugee, my grandfather came in. Born and brought up in Orissa, married to a Bengali, and now living in Tamil Nadu. I am a graduate in physics, a postgraduate in business management, and now pursuing an MPhil in philosophy. I started out as a manager in a manufacturing firm, moved on to become a consultant in a consulting firm, which is a services industry, and now I run my own publishing company. I am a black belt in karate, an Odissi dancer, and I'm learning Russian ballet. The idea of this introduction is not a deafening blowing of my trumpet, but though I have successfully managed to do that, but to introduce you my topic, which is connecting the dots. These are the various disparate dots of my life, which were there ever since I was aware of myself as a student, as a child. I could never say this is my favorite subject. I liked science, I liked English, I liked Hindi, I liked all the sports. And that was in the 70s, where specialization was the order of the day. And I was a complete misfit, because at school I was interested in everything. I could never participate in a debate competition because I thought the other person's point of view is also valid. And yet, we had to very vehemently put forward our point of view. So this is how I grew up till the age of 16, when I chanced upon Sri Aurobindo. And that is where I got the largest canvas of my life, where I could connect all the dots. This is what Sri Aurobindo means to me, because my identity depends on him. I began reading Sri Aurobindo, which is different from studying him, from that early age, and I was very, very lucky to have Amal Kiran, K.D. Setna, as somebody I would be with for the whole day, trying to read Sri Aurobindo in a desultory fashion. If I wanted to know something about some topic, I would pick up letters on yoga. If I wanted to know about faith, it would be from somewhere. And this is how it went on for quite a while, which is about 20 years. Till one day, I found myself in front of a huge jigsaw puzzle. I had all the pieces, you know, and there was this board, and there was this very deep, intense aspiration to begin putting the jigsaw puzzle together. By then, I was married. I had a son who was 6 years old. I had a business to run. And from a practical point of view, I decided to enroll at Sakar, because then it does not remain a secondary endeavor or occupation, but it becomes more primary because it is more structured and it is systematic. So this is what brings me to the study of Sri Aurobindo, which I would differentiate from a reading of him. The reading of Sri Aurobindo takes care of two quadrants of our life. One is the subjective understanding of yourself. You can know more and more about yourself when you read Sri Aurobindo to clarify the various aspects of your path of growth. And the objective understanding of the reality. When you want to know about the political system or the human unity, you read the Human Cycle, Ideal of Humanity, and so on. It is only the study of Sri Aurobindo, where you dwell on him, on his works, that the other two quadrants begin to fill up, which is a subjective understanding of the world and an objective understanding of yourself. This has been the journey so far. It has been only 6 months that we have begun here. And I would like to from Sri Aurobindo's point of view, say, why is there a need to read Sri Aurobindo? In four aids, which Sri Aurobindo talks about, which we need for our inner development, he talks about the guru, who we need, the shastra, the utsaha, and the kala. The first one, he says, guru, we need for any endeavor. He says, for integral yoga, the guru is the inner Veda secret who is seated in the heart of every living being. So that is the guru. The shastra for us is the works of Mother and Sri Aurobindo. Sri Aurobindo was very particular that people who are trying to follow his path should understand what it is. I read somewhere he says that all of few should read The Life Divine, you know, and when you read it, one realizes that it is like the creator speaking about his own creation. There cannot be a better explanation to why the creation was. And then there is utsaha and this. So Sri Aurobindo himself gives the importance of shastra for integral development, and therefore he has to be read. Secondly, when I was reading Nolinita, I found that he says that every ascent from matter to plant life to mind has a corresponding descent that takes place. Now we are at a stage of progress where there has to be this leap from the mind to the supermind through the various other ranges in between. Nolinida says in his article that it is not by itself that the descent will happen. There has to be, as the mother also, Sri Aurobindo says in the mother, a calling from below. There has to be a churning, there has to be a seeking, there has to be an aspiration. And the mind has to seek it in its intensity for the descent to happen. And this is, and studying Sri Aurobindo is therefore very essential there, because over and above having the mantric quality, which both his poetry and prose contain, to understand him, one has to try to or be in that, you know, what we call the higher mind stage. I mean, when we have certain revelations or certain understanding of Sri Aurobindo's different thoughts and ideas, it means we have very momentarily, maybe, you know, transcended our limited mind. And this, when it happens over a period of time, it certainly makes our mind more ripe. And thirdly, supramentalization proceeds from psychicization through spiritualization and finally to supramentalization. While psychicization is something where we deepen ourselves, spiritualization is opening up of, is heightening, it is, you know, opening the higher regions of the mind. And Sri Aurobindo has said that since mind is now the highest faculty that man has, that has to be used for the ascent. So these are the reasons why mental consciousness, its development is essential. Coming to some interesting understandings and learnings on the way, I would like to put across a couple of points. We did Sri Aurobindo's and his life and his essential thought. And all of us know that Sri Aurobindo was born in 1872 and the mother in 1876. I think I know it for the last 20 years. 1878, I'm sorry. But the other day when I was going through their lives, the outer life, it never interested me, Sri Aurobindo's outer life, because I was more interested in his later part. But as a part of the course, we had to study it, and something very interesting came about. You know, astrologically, they say the number 6 is the most difficult. Two people who have number 6 in their ascendants or horoscope, I don't know that much, do not get along or something. When I looked at Madan Sri Aurobindo's life, you will see the interesting coincidence. Sri Aurobindo was born in 1872 and mother in 1878. The difference is 6. Sri Aurobindo was born in August, mother in February. The difference is 6 months. Sri Aurobindo was born, what is that? 15th of August, mother on the 21st. Difference is 6 days. And when they passed away, 7:25 was when the mother passed away, and 1:25 a.m. was Sri Aurobindo. It's again 6 hours. So I was, so this is what dwelling on these things can do, you know, these interesting insights. Also, what moved me in the Sri Aurobindo's early life was his revolutionary days. Very easily, you know, we say things like, God will take care of Sri Aurobindo, you know, what can happen to India? Sri Aurobindo was the most qualified person for that, but he didn't stop at that. He went and made bombs, he went to the prison. So that reminded me of what I'd read years ago, that in the synthesis, it is said that wherever one is, one can start on this journey. You know, sincerity is to just accept where one is and start from there. In foundations, there were very interesting insights too, but I'm running short of time. All I would like to say is I'm happy I'm studying at Sakar. The facilitators are fantastic. The reference material is very good. And I hope and I'm sure that with the canvas that is getting wider by the day, I will be able to connect all the dots that may emerge in future, and I'm sure which they will. Thank you.
My name is Chandra. I grew up in the ashram here. And my university years were in France, that was long back, in various disciplines that interested me. And I'm back to studies after a long gap. And the two questions I would like to answer is why I took up Sri Aurobindo's studies in Sakar, and how it feels to be studying Sri Aurobindo academically. Now, why did I want to study Sri Aurobindo is, very honestly, the real and true answer is I don't know. I just don't know. It was a sudden inspiration. I mean, suddenly I felt a kind of urgency to do it, and I would have shaken up the coconut tree to be able to do it. But I didn't have to do that, and that's another matter. I mean, Anandbhai was very kind to me and said, yeah, sure, you can come. If I rationalize some of my feelings, then I can say that here is an author, like Sri Aurobindo, with whom I had the most delicious conversations. I mean, I felt very intelligent, learning very deep things. And he is so sweet that he would just sweep me off my feet, and I was very happy. So that was a wonderful sensation. And I just thought that I want to get more. So I thought that probably by getting into the studies, I could prolong that sweetness and just spend hours and hours with him. So that was it. I suddenly would have done anything, absolutely anything, to be able to spend more time with him. Coming to the second question, how does it feel to study Sri Aurobindo academically? I should say that before, when I used to read him, I felt like I was in the flow. And then I came to Sakar, and Sakar hands you out a magnifying glass and a pair of binoculars, a ruler, a compass, and whatnot. And you see a text emerging out of the landscape, and you start looking at its parts, its structure. You notice more and more things. And when you've really stretched yourself out, understanding the text, and you've done your very best, then there's a fantastic teacher like Belu, for example, who points out little sentences as if she was saying, like, have you looked into this corner? And she asks you little questions. And all those are like new questions, and suddenly you have to stretch out even more. And then you start sliding into the text, and it helps you to go deeper and deeper into it and make the whole more connected and start highlighting the little parts that, like little jewels that start shining out to you. And it's the intention to understand and to know that seem to arouse in me the personal interest and the push to ask questions, and also the intention to go into the text and see what is revealed therein, which had to deepen and to go further. In my case, at least, the quest for knowledge is not disinterested, as we find in Plato or carried through as an assumption in science today. My intention to know and understand becomes the driving force in my learning experience, and it is the motive and the motivation. And finally, the one most important and beautiful word that stayed with me from the very beginning, and which I keep repeating to my friends on why I felt so special being here in Sakar, was uttered, this word was uttered by my teacher Anandai. And when he said, if you sit in front of the master and don't say anything, then the master will also keep quiet. And you have to become his friend. You have to be like Arjun was Sri Krishna's friend, and ask him questions and keep questioning him, and he will start revealing himself to you. This went really straight to my heart and sounded like so true, so real, and it made me feel that I was at the right place and with the right teacher here in Sakar, and I felt at home. I felt completely in sync and very, very grateful. And studying here has been very, very happy for me.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. I'm so happy to be here and very grateful to Dr. Ananda Reddy and Sakar to give such opportunity, which I hardly get. It's a platform to churn oneself. I'm Anshuman Basu. I was fortunate enough to meet mother physically at the age of 5 in 1970. Though mother wanted my parents to keep me here in the ashram, but my father didn't want that. So I had to do my studies, formal education in Assam and then in Calcutta, then in Siliguri. But my mind and my heart, everything was always in the ashram and Auroville and to be here. My grand uncle was an ashramite, Biren Chandra. So every year we used to come here. I'm telling all these stories because Sri Aurobindo was more involved in me practically. So that's the thing, how it happened. So then I didn't have my formal education properly, and I was always suffering by an inferiority complex, because I left my studies many times and I was toiling in the soil of Auroville or somewhere in the working in the departments of ashram. Then my grandfather was not very happy with me because I was a vagabond here. But every time I felt Sri Aurobindo. So I would emphatically say that Sri Aurobindo is not just a theory, he's a decisive action direct from the Supreme. Because he appeared in my dreams, in my visions many times, and he spoke to me, though I don't want to say that, I mean, to make myself, surely many people have seen him or heard him, but he was so clear that somebody was telling in the morning that
Do you know about premonition, how this premonition? Long, long time back, 17 years ago, I just met Dr. Ananda Reddy when he was just a professor in university, and I told him, I want to learn Sri Aurobindo from you. And he was surprised also in the front of Surguru Hotel. He said, suddenly how you ask this? Okay, you can come and meet me at university. That time I didn't know that I would be joining Sakar after 17 years. But it just happened. Sri Aurobindo was there in me. I didn't have an education. I was in Oroville. But then I went back many times and then ultimately completed my graduation from Calcutta University. I wanted to do many things, couldn't. But here, how Sri Aurobindo gave me education, how he developed me. I learned massage and everything. One day I saw a vision where Sri Aurobindo was sitting in front of me and I was in his feet. And his eyebrows became like this while he was trying to move his hand. And I jumped up and I said, can I offer you a massage? He said, no, thank you. Then he said, what do you want, my child? And I said, I got so elated and nervous, I couldn't say anything. I just became very, you know, fumbling. And then he said, do you want to go abroad? I said, no. Then he said, what do you want then? I said, I want knowledge. And he said, good, very good. Then his image vanished. Then you see this happen. I joined Sakar, and it's a good platform to develop intellectually or study intellect. Otherwise, we are so much involved in our daily life, we hardly have time to study Sri Aurobindo, you know, in an academic way or in a serious manner. I have started reading Mother at the age of 15, from when I was in class 8 or 9. I almost read Mother, everything, but not Sri Aurobindo. Sri Aurobindo is living. So I would like to recite his poem, Who? I'm just trying to do that, you see. Who? He is the power, the supreme. And Sri Aurobindo also is, you know, is telling that, who is that energy, the consciousness? Now there was a question about defined consciousness. It's so subtle, how can one define consciousness? But Sri Aurobindo is there with everyone at his own level, maybe, you know. And this poem also is quite, he's also asking the question. In the blue of the sky, in the green of the forest, whose is the hand that has painted the glow? When the winds were asleep, in the wombs of the ether, who was it roused them and bade them to glow? He is lost in the heart, in the cavern of nature. He is found in the brain where he builds the thought. In the pattern and the bloom of the flowers he's woven, in the luminous net of the stars he's caught, in the laugh of a boy, in the blush of a girl, the hand that sent Jupiter spinning through heaven spends all its cunning to fashion a girl. These are his works, his veils and his shadows, but where is he then? By what name is he known? Is he Brahma or Vishnu? A man or a woman, bodied or bodiless, twin or alone. We have a love for a boy who is dark and resplendent. A woman is lord of us, naked and fierce. We have seen him amuse in the snow of the mountains. We have watched him at work in the heart of the spheres. These are his, then? His strength that is loud, all music is only the sound of his laughter. All beauty, the smile, is passionate bliss. Our lives are his heartbeats. Our rapture, the bridal of Radha and Krishna. Our love is the kiss. There's another very important stanza is, we will tell the whole world of his ways and his cunnings. He has a rapture of torture and passion and pain. He derives... Yeah, sorrows, please join. He delights in our sorrows and drives us to weeping that happened in me when I was in Oroville. Then lures with his joy and his beauty again. It is he in the sun, ageless and deathless, and into the midnight his shadow is thrown. When darkness was blind and engulfed within darkness, He was seated within it, immense and alone. There was many other stanzas I forgot. Sorry, thank you so much.
Now I'm so happy today because I wanted to come and speak here, because when this the idea of Sakar and then affiliation to Ignau came, I was a little skeptical. I knew that there will be a lot of institutional problem and all that, but Anand was a very great idealist and he said he would go through. I said I'll be very happy, and then it came to me when he said yes, everything is true. I said your center will go a long way in Aurobindo studies. I think I'm right in that context. And one best part of I wanted to tell Anand, for the first time you are lucky, because the true spirit of the university, where the freedom, and you know, we are not mathas or old type of schools, we are the true modern. And incidentally, I happen to be in a university where all these things are not there, the freedom and then to teach and to expand the horizons of knowledge. But then I'm lucky, you are lucky that you could, and you are doing a great service. And I'm so happy that this was the purpose that when we envisioned, or he envisioned in that context. And then I said, yes, affiliation you should have, because these are the times of legitimacy and brands and brandings. And Ignau also started. Let me share one more thing about Ignau. Was the idea of Ignau actually came from his father, again inspired by Sri Aurobindo. He wrote an article in 70s, University Without Walls. And actually that was picked up, and for the first time the open universities came in Andhra Pradesh, and that was the time. And you know these things, in a when it goes to the administration, the many other professors bag it and take it away, the ideas. And then it was Andhra Pradesh which started first open university, and then that Indira Gandhi liked that idea, and then it became an Ignau. And I'm so glad that Ignau has associated with this thing, and we were actively involved. And then at the time of preparation of syllabus, I suggested him, don't keep Aurobindo alone, connect it. And wonderful things that have happened here and happening here, maybe few students, but then I can say that you have done a great job. Thanks to the students.
Wide heterogeneity of the four speakers who spoke, and having an homogeneous platform, the students would like to appreciate very much I appreciated very much at this mature age, shifting from transactional analysis to Sri Aurobindo. It's a very great, I being a psychiatrist, I can understand that. It's not a thing, it's a very difficult thing. When transactional analysis came in, I mean, I still remember in Calcutta, when the Indian Institute of Management was trying to introduce it, they were failing, because in Calcutta at that time they found out that groups initiating in India, they made subgroups and they were backstabbing, so it couldn't succeed. And they were at that time they were not fighting any other group. No, SHW thing, that's why came with this Indian values. But that time it didn't lead that something. What you are doing today, that shifting to Sri Aurobindo thing can go. But that at this mature age of shifting is very nice. I've been waiting it much. I could understand by hearing Gita Giri that she's the famous Gita Giri who is in the air. I understood. His presentation was also, I appreciate Oshma's presentation was very nice. Maybe then you missed one or two lines. Actually, you see that you missed some of the verses added to what you are, actually.
Thank you. I'm also a proud student of SATA. I write questions and comments now. now we have 10 minutes more than that.
You're honorary student. She's an honorary student. Mike.
You're doing counseling to students. And I feel we should start the counseling from the teacher's level at this stage.
Mike.
Do you have any plans to do that? Because the first is the teachers who have need to be counseled.
You're right that I should go counsel the teachers too.
Yeah, that is the first step.
Who will make them sit in front of me? That's the greatest difficulty.
No, I'm not talking about this small score of people. I'm talking about the mass.
It's true. It is essential for them. I have in fact a program called FIT, Faculty Improvement Training. I pray that I only will make them fit teachers. But they are not attended. So, I must congratulate them. Counseling is the most essential part of India. I was a school teacher for 21 years. I was a gold medalist of mathematics. I left in 2004. I saved many lives. The students were in stress. And they were just disturbing, you say, right in the process. When the students come to the classroom, but on the way, at the home, during the home, with the friends, on the net, what they are in real sense they are doing is the urgent need for counselors. There has a many role to play. I suggested my management to introduce the counseling system. They were unable to cope up and manage this. So I left my school and I started my own system of training the students. I really appreciate the work that you are doing and thanks this opportunity that they are providing some. Right now it is also urgent need. Online education is an excellent concept. When Brazil's successful teachers are European countries are doing online training and many philosophical talks, many videos, audios are available. But if we can introduce via this system to facilitate these courses through internet throughout the Indian continent, I think it is not an easy job, a challenging job. We are with you. It's a great challenge and God bless you. Thank you very much. We are here. You need this thank you.
My name is Nandala and I stay here as well as I stay in Singapore. Professor Mahathir was telling that he has done this, he has done this. I thought that whether he has done this or not, because I think only Sri Aurobindo wanted him to do this. Let me give you an insight. He was in Bangkok. And from Bangkok in the university or somewhere, he has finished his job or something like that. I tried my best to detain him in Singapore. I have done so much that he should not come here, but he should be there in Singapore. But I think I was not successful. Otherwise, you should have named me today. The Saka would not have been there. I am right from the beginning in Saka, with the growth of Saka. Then when he came here, so he was a poor student with my daughter or with my son? My daughter?
My son.
Yeah, Ashok. Together with my son. So, I would say that how fortunate he is and how fortunate you people are that Saka came. And when I came here after 3 years, and I've seen that Saka is growing, growing, and growing. In the whole conversations and sessions here, I'm most satisfied for this session.
Well, I'll take a couple of minutes. This being Saka's afternoon, it seems. I think it's legitimate that I should speak a little bit about Saka. Although most of you here know about it, you have heard a little bit from Lahoti, and I think the central point was given by Nanda Nandan. Well, he even contacted the education minister in Singapore to get me a job. I was even interviewed for the job, and you know, the salary was fixed and everything was done. But as I said, somebody up there is sanctioning. So, thank you. That's true. Well, having come, of course, we did start from the scratch. Right in 1992, we laid the foundation of Saka right here where this young people are sitting here. That's the foundation stone is right at this place of the Saka. So we had only this bit of land, a little bit of maybe near the storeroom. So my father and myself, we started planning Saka in this hall area. And of course, my father and me, we had decided that the research center in Shorabindo should be always at Pondicherry, because that's the synonymous with Pondicherry is Shorabindo. So we laid the foundation, but then I had to leave out Bangkok for whatever reasons. And when I was absent, the government of Pondicherry took away even this piece of land. So they said it's meant for the fishermen, and then you know it had to be given to the poor people. And my father had to approach the chief minister of Tamil Nadu and the Chennai at the time to somehow got this, you know, back to Saka. When I came back, the line was clearly ours. But you know, I think one thing I've learned through in Saka in this building is wherever there was a door closed, the wider gate was open for me. That's the one thing that has gone deep into my psyche. I mean, I've never even in my dreams had acknowledged that. Because many a time, many doors were closed on me, but I saw a huge gate on the other side opened up for me. One little incident. When I came, you see the left side wall, there's a compound wall here. That was supposed to be the entry point for this land. In fact, when we did this foundation, we came right here. This was the approach road. When I came back from Bangkok, my great neighbors blocked me with the whole wall there. I couldn't even enter my own plot. Then what do I do? So somebody said, no, go to the court, you know, get the wall demolished and all that. But I said, I don't go to lower courts, I go straight to the Supreme Court. And that was the Supreme Mother. Well, one fine morning, my own mechanic, motorcycle mechanic, he comes to my house and says, sir, I'd like to show you a plot. I said, I had enough of trouble with one plot, I don't want it anymore. He said, no, sir, just come with me. He sits behind my bike, I'll show you. So he came right in front of the door where the gate is. And he showed me a piece of land. He said, this is a piece of land you'd like to have. And I saw there that that piece of land was connecting this piece of land. And I knew what the mother wanted. I said, not the entry is there, not at the back. So I didn't tell the broker anything. I said, yes, I think I can take that land. So my father was there, luckily he had a property, and I said, Baba, there's a lovely land, and the little friends connecting our own plot. Papa said, I have no money. I said, fine. Luckily, we had come back from Bangkok, so we had some fixed deposit. I released the fixed deposit, bought this land. And there was the Saka egg shape that you see there. But I know already I may get a chick like that, but before I get that, let me. Now, this is how Visakha began, the physical building. So it took me 2.5 years. And at that time, when I had the first, the engineer, the contractor, many people said, it's a beautiful project and we would like to offer you free service. So I gave this plot for development, for building to a contractor, and I went on a world trip at that time. And that's the first time I went abroad, around the world, which you can myself, we made a trip. I had 36 talks on the way, and there are many places. And my contractor engineer said, you should get some money when you're going abroad, try to get, have some donations or some fundraising. And I thought I can do that. And I was very confident, after all, the world trip, somewhere or the other, I'll get some money. But I failed miserably. And the reason, because I chose the donor, and that's one mistake I made. And I learned after that, never choose your donor. It's she who chooses the donor for her work. So I have this tremendous faith. From now onwards, it's not my damn business to build Visakha. And I was a contractor of the mother. And I said, the day you stop money on the bank, that very weekend, on Saturday, I close this project. So that was a secret challenge between me and the mother. And we both signed on the day on stamp paper. And she kept up her promise, and I kept up my word. There's only one condition that Pranodha had told me. Never misuse mother's money, not even a rupee. And always keep perfect accounting of what I get. So I started depending on her. But on my way back, again, my uncle here, another uncle, he called me for a talk. Because, whenever I pass at the airport of Singapore, he is the customs officer, he knows when I'm ready there. So he grabs me and says, you're going to give a talk, etc. And I gave a talk. And there I told about the project. And somebody from the audience, she said, I'm ready by this evening. I'll give you a check for 100 rupees. So that was the first time I breathed some money. I said, my God, the last lap of the day, somebody is giving 1 lakh of rupees. So I came home, at the airport, I was given 1 lakh of rupees. So that was the first lap. And then when I returned home, I was really enthusiastic to start this. However, there's a very long, long story how it got built, because actually, as Nandaji said, Sri Aurobindo wanted it and mother built it. Because frankly, it's not humility even to say that she built it, it's an absolute rock-bottom reality. Because I have neither the Sri Aurobindo ashram to support me, nor the Sri Aurobindo society, not a big name for Aurobindo. There's no big name attached to me. And that was very great advantage. Because that taught me to really depend on the people. Because every Saturday, when a bill comes for 2 lakhs, or 4 lakhs, or 5 lakhs, it is a realistic figure. You cannot say, Natasi left next week longer. That cannot be done. Because he's a laborer who comes with a bill of 4 lakhs. And I never knew from where I got the money. And my accountants, I think they do not know how I got the money, only maybe they know it, I don't know. Because every weekend, there was sufficient money, just 50,000 plus or 9,000, to give the next bill. I think she knew next month there was 5 lakhs, so she would put 5.5 lakhs in the bank. And that was again a great training. I never had the full money, I never had 70 lakhs or 80 lakhs to start the project. Then I would become lazy and my aspiration would go down. But here was I. My aspiration was kept alive, my surrender was kept alive. And my honesty, sincerity, not to misuse a single rupee of the mother. It was a tremendous training. It's not a building of Visakha, it was a training of my own self. So there were all kinds of new people in my class. People gave me 5 rupees to 50 rupees to 500 rupees, and somebody in Delhi gave me 5 lakhs of rupees. And I went to London, somebody gave me 10 lakhs of rupees. I mean, it's been a story, a miraculous story, a concretely miraculous story. That's how Sakha got built. Well, once the building was done in 2000, when the man February, we inaugurated Sakha right up. So now this is 10 years of Sakha. So it's again a landmark in the growth of Sakha. But in 10 years, we have done this much of progress. Right from the building we started this scratch. And then there was this land above, opposite that you see, there was a garden space, which did not belong to us. But again, in Singapore, somebody was there. It was again a friend of Nandaraji. So you can see how much Nandaraji Devi was in the picture of the growth of Sakha. Again, that land was there. That was not to be mine. But I needed money. The gentleman gave me some money. He promised to give me that. And how I got repaid is against us. So then I got again a sweet letter. So the sweet reminders are very good ones. So I think I take a little more time so I can get a second one. Well, I know next session, my own sister is there. Daughter is there. They're waiting eagerly to come out. But let me tell you, because some of your new bills are coming. So that's the beginning part. I mean, it's a miracle. It's big. I mean, it is purely. And none of my friends knew what I was doing, the ashram friends or outside friends. It was done so silently. And after it was done, somebody from the ashram came by. They said, my God, we never knew that in Pondicherry you were building such a huge complex. I mean, people thought Sakha to be a one-room tenement or a two-room building or something. But it was something incredible. So one day, one incident I should tell you, that Bhutapaya, whom all of you know, who has been the artist for Sarvati's paintings. So she came, she stood near the car park and cycle park. She stood there, staring at the building. She said, and it was 2:30 in the afternoon, imagine, it's hot sun. She stood at the sun and said, Didi, why did you come under the shade? So when she came here, she came right into this hall and she said, I asked her, Didi, why is it that you are looking at this building with such curiosity? She said, when did you imagine, when did you plan this building? This time, when did you complete it? This year. She said, Anand, you will not believe me, I have seen this very building in an occult world. And I am amazed. The reason why I am looking at the building is, what I saw up there is down here. Exactly the window pattern, the color of the window, the pillar, the whole thing, she says, it has come down. The building has not been built, it has been brought down. And then the whole secret was there, how within 3 years, an incognito, an incompoop like Anand Reddy could gather 1 crore of rupees. And who brings that? Because the building was an occult reality. And she saw that she saw it, and then she said, the truth of Sakha is somewhere else. So she said, Anand, you're not planning it, you're not doing it. And I said, Uttarayan, we even before you can say that, I have heard it. So Sakha had that very auspicious birth. And then after that, of course, you know, friends came, daddy came, others came. And then I didn't even know the name of what is the meaning of a virtual university, but you know, at that time, as I said, what Lahori said, my father had written in 1972 to the mother. And the mother had named this the University of Tomorrow. She started that university, gave that name, gave it a blessing, and then she started that University of Tomorrow. And my father had given a long introduction of what it should be in the life of the mother's and children's vision, which was sent to the mother again. So it was a kind of an authentic thing, and it had a reality somewhere. But unfortunately, my father passed away before he could realize anything of that. But in 2002, it suddenly came to me that this university cannot be a local, physical, locational, geographical thing. Because surely knowing the universal cosmic consciousness, who should be available to the whole earth in a single moment, not somebody comes all the way to Pondicherry. There is idea of the internet game or the online game. I registered the name in the University of Tomorrow and all that, you know, the technical details. And very soon, mother had really prepared me sometime, you know, she had a long-standing preparation. When I was on my tour in the USA, I met with Larry. He was only my guide to show me the great waterfalls. So I stayed with him. And again, one fine morning, he comes to Saka and says, let's show me, writes to me, can I join this great adventure of the University of Tomorrow? So then he was here, staying in Saka, and then we started planning what can be a virtual university. And in 2004, we floated this university. We had our website, we started our courses. And Jamshed was one of the very first students, I know it is here. And then there was Randall Brand who was here in the morning session. We had just three students to begin with. And my colleague said, should we start? I said, yeah, that's how Ashram also began. 3 persons or 5 persons, their mother running happened in a big way. It is a gradual growth. So we started with 3 persons. And then since 2004, we had lots of seminars and slowly started to be known as an academic world. And 2008, after 2 or 3 years of attempting to really affiliate Saka to some university, there was sudden news from Baroda University. And that was the first blessing I got from Shivananda, came a confirmation that he is with me. Because the first university that recognized Saka at an official level was the Baroda University, where Shivananda himself was there, the professor. And for that, I must thank Sarasandra Joshi, whom you have heard. He was very instrumental, and I knew that mother had kept him there, her own devotee. He was a pro myself at that time, so there could have been a better man for me, and he did his best. Because all this has to go to the academic world, and I really fought for it, and I got the first recognition. But unfortunately, it was just one department that recognized us, the department of philosophy. But what about Savitri? But what about human cycle? What about future poetry? There are so many other things. And in just a couple of months, if this happened January and March, I got a letter from IGNO, from the Russia Pillai, who had also come in 2004 for a similar seminar in Saka. He came, he sat right here, he saw Saka's work and was very impressed with what was being given then. So in 2008, when I wrote to him about this university, can we have affiliation, within 10 days the answer came saying, why don't you fly down to Delhi and we could see how we could work out along with Saka. And there began the new romance with IGNO. But that was a new romance. Within 6 months, we exchanged the betrothal ring, that was the MOU. But then, you know, all the problems start once you are married. The romance was very good. It went out very well. There was only one priest, that was Ashwin Pillai, and there was a sub-priest called the Professor Lata Pillai, Dr. Lata Pillai. And so there are not many audiences there, except, you know, Dr. Karan Singh and Kirin Joshi and S.N. Joshi and a few of us at that time, Delu and Shiro Temi. But you know, all problems of life are problems of harmony. But I would say all problems of life begin after marriage. So we got married with IGNO, we exchanged rings, we exchanged MOUs. But then there is no consummation till now. The registration is not taking place, there are some problems, you know, we are got into a problem that some of my faculty saying, hey, we will get part, have the right partner. I said, look, I got married to IGNO and I am not sure the right group. So don't bother. Things will change. Let's have patience. And that's how slowly we are developing a new relation. Because, you know, IGNO is a huge oceanic place and we are one little dot in that. It's a massive program. If you go into IGNO's campus, you will see thousands and thousands of students, programs, 2,000 programs. And I wonder often how the pro vice chancellors manage to show up there, hundreds of departments. So this is luckily we have here Professor P.R. Srivastan here. This is the first time somebody from IGNO is coming to Saka after the visit of Professor Pillai. I'm sure he's seen Saka in his work. I'm sure he has heard our own students, how they are happy with us. So I think this teething problem, as we say, will get over that. But this is a wonderful opportunity. The Sakha can grow and will grow. And you see, it's not IGNU supporting us. IGNU is giving us a wide screen, a wide canvas, as somebody said. But I do not want to lose the identity of Sakha. And that's what Brother Srivastava always emphasized, that you are partner institutions coming up with a novelty approach. They would like to protect our approach. And that was a wonderful, healthy attitude I've seen in Brother Srivastava. That they want to protect us. They don't want to dissolve our identity in IGNU. So even he's playing the new rules for that. So this was the whole thing. But when we started in 1998, I had to form a trust body. And again, I must say, here I have Manorama Viraya, who is like my sister, Elder Devi, who is one of my trustee members. So she has encouraged me, helped me. She has had some wide contacts. But more than the monetary help, I think her support like a deity that has been great for me, because you know, in such a venture, you need some of the road people to be with you. So I should again thank Didi here. She runs her own center at Bangalore, Aradhana Trust, and she has a wonderful center. She has built a beautiful center. But for me, it has been a tremendous support. So I think with the help of all of you, we have built Sakha here. Later on, people like Bedu join, people like Suhash, and then the two youngsters behind me, Satya and Nivesh, who one fine morning they come, you know, all exhausted, all disappointed, you know, as if the life had come to an end, then they said, well, Sakha is the only door open. We want to just join Sakha. We don't want any money from you. Just give us a shelter and nothing more. And there are really seekers who have gone to the ashram dining room, who have gone to Oroville, who have worked here, there, and then ultimately they landed here, and they really landed on some rooms. So that they have become one of the pillars of Sakha, each one managing one big section. So we have a small family, but it is each member is an inevitable member. And with such Sakha family, we have done for the first time here this time to celebrate Sri Aurobindo's coming. This has been a huge effort for us, because post Sri Aurobindo's centenary, I have revamped this entire building. You people do not understand the work that has gone into it. Cleaned up every corner, painted every corner, every grill, everything. And so it's been last 4 to 5 months I've been on it, at it day in and day out. But all this requires money. And when I spoke about this to a couple of my friends, they are extremely generous to come out. Somebody says, I'll give you 50%. Somebody said, the other 50% I'll give you. And the mother was showing her grace, and I said, again, the contractor is not ready, he was born again. So I became a contractor for the last 6 months. So I was a super contractor to the painters, to the laborers, to the carpenters, everyone. And now I've come out of the contract. And I'm back to my academic, I suppose. So friends, what you see behind has been a show by helping hands, many of them, who do not want to be named, so I'm not naming them. Except one person who says he wouldn't mind being named. That is in the foundation by, I don't know if you know the name. However, he wants to be known as Indic Foundation that's helped me in some funds. And others don't want to be mentioned in this open forum. But again, openly, I must thank them for the silent help. Because a structure is always, a top is always made by two ways. So what all our friends, our students are telling about me and our baby and Larry and the whole thing, there's a solid base supporting. And the real base is Mother Ishwar. So I've been only a contractor, nothing more in this world. So the Taj Mahal was built by so-and-so, the king. Unfortunately, this is the king's name goes. But nobody remembers the thousands of labor, the architect, the painter, the artist, whose names do not appear. So I do not want to take any name in this building for myself. I will try, but all of us be named in building this Sakha. Thank you.